One evening early in 1948, President Harry Truman was visited by General Dwight D. Eisenhower, the supreme commander of the Allied Expeditionary Forces during World War II. The reason for the general's visit was to convince the president to give the highest award possible that may be bestowed upon a foreign national, the Legion of Merit, to the Serbian Chetnik General Draža Mihailović. Eisenhower made the case for the Serbian general, and the president enthusiastically agreed and personally signed the approval for the award. But, due to pressure from the U.S. State Department, the award was categorized as top secret. In this way, the American president appeased the communist government of Yugoslavia by promising that it would never become known that General Mihailović received the award. This is the only such time in American history that the Legion of Merit was bestowed in secret and then kept secret from the public. The award itself sat in the drawer of some desk in some office deep in the basement of the United States Department of State for more than 20 years. In this program, we will examine how and why this happened and how a remarkable chain of events that began with acts of heroism and loyalty ended with acts of betrayal, abandonment, and national shame.
Bandits. That's what they are. Bandits. And they will be treated as such when I get my hands on them. The Yugoslavian armies have been defeated. Belgrade and every other city of importance has been occupied. And yet these Chetniks. These Chetniks are holding 7 divisions here when they should be on other fronts. Under international law, these brigands can expect no mercy when I catch their leader,
Mihailović is his name. Draža Mihailović.
Whatever his name is, he shall suffer for his refusal to lay down his arms. My orders are to rid Yugoslavia of this man. We know that he is somewhere in these mountains. Life or death. I want Draža Mihailović.
The story of Operation Halyard, the rescue of 512 Allied airmen trapped behind enemy lines, is one of the greatest rescue and escape stories ever. But almost no one has heard about it. And that is by design. The American, British, and Yugoslav governments hid details of this story for decades, purposefully denying credit to the heroic rescuers and the foreign ally who gave his life to help Allied airmen as they were hunted down by Nazis in the hills of Yugoslavia. Operation Halyard was the largest rescue ever of downed American airmen and one of the largest such operations in the Second World War or since. Hundreds of American airmen were rescued, along with some from other countries, right under the noses of the Germans, and mostly in broad daylight. The mission was a complete success, the kind that should have been trumpeted in newsreels and published on the front page of the newspapers, but it wasn't. It is a little-known episode that started with one edge-of-your-seat rescue in August of 1944, followed by a series of additional rescues over several months. American agents from the OSS, the precursor of the CIA, worked with a Serbian guerrilla, General Draža Mihailović, to carry out the huge, ultra-secret rescue mission. This is the story of young airmen shot down in the hills of Yugoslavia during bombing runs, and the 4 secret agents who conducted their amazing rescue. These are the stories of young men, many of them first-generation Americans, the proud, patriotic sons of European immigrants, who were eager to join the war and fight the Germans, even finding excitement and the often deadly trips from Italy to bomb the German oil fields in Romania, but who found themselves parachuting out of crippled planes and into the arms of strange, rough-looking villagers in a country they knew nothing about. They soon found that the local Serbs were willing to sacrifice their own lives to keep the down airmen out of German hands, but they still wondered if anyone was coming for them, or if they would spend the rest of the war hiding from German patrols and barely surviving on goat's milk and bread baked with hay to make it more filling. Gregory A. Freeman.
In the spring of 1941, the Prince Regent of Yugoslavia, Paul, signed an agreement with Hitler that Yugoslavia would be associated with the Nazis. This caused a reaction by young officers who revolted in the capital, Belgrade, and all over Yugoslavia, and who did not want to make any kind of an agreement with the Nazis and didn't want Yugoslavia to participate on the side of Nazis. One of those young officers who took over Yugoslavia and frankly got rid of the rule of Prince Paul was Colonel Draža Mihailović, who was one of the regular Yugoslavian army top brilliant officers. As soon as Hitler heard that, that Yugoslavia revolted against the pact, he got very angry and he ordered an attack on Yugoslavia to be prepared. On April 6, 1941, German planes attacked Belgrade, the capital of Yugoslavia, and bombed it mercilessly, killing about 20,000 people inside a couple hours. This was the biggest bombing of Yugoslavia until the United States bombed Yugoslavia during the Kosovo War. And then Germany invaded Yugoslavia, and the Yugoslavian army, for the most part, surrendered, except for a few leading officers. One of them was Draža Mihailović, who led remnants of the regular army who would refuse to surrender, something like De Gaulle did in France, and also irregulars who volunteered to join him, who were called Chetniks. And they became the basis of the resistance movement in Yugoslavia until later, when the Soviet Union was invaded by Germany several months later, Tito started the resistance against the Germans as well. So we had two resistance groups in Yugoslavia, Tito and Draža Mihailović and the Chetniks. Chetniks were predominantly Serbian, though not all Serbians. There were many who were Croatians as well who joined the Chetniks, and there was very strong support for the Chetniks in Dalmatia and some other areas as well. We have a huge guerrilla war starting in Yugoslavia where the Chetniks were very active at first against the Germans. Before the partisans did anything, the Chetniks were very active. However, the Germans took incredibly harsh revenge on the civilian population of Yugoslavia, and they started killing like 100 civilians for every German who was killed by the resistance. And in one place, a place called Kragujevac, they killed over 1,000 people because 10 Germans were killed by the resistance, which caused a number of the Chetniks to stop doing active guerrilla warfare in a way that could be blamed on the local area. And this led to the increasing belief in America and England that the Chetniks were collaborators, and that Draža Mihailović was a collaborator, he was the leader, the main leader of the Chetniks. Well, in actuality, he was just trying to hold on, do what he could, while causing as little repercussion for the civilian population as well. In a certain areas, he actually made agreements with the Germans, which would be like a truce. They wouldn't fight each other for a while. This was taken up by Tito and the partisans as an example of collaboration by Draža Mihailović and alleged war crimes, when in fact we know that now that the partisans did the same thing at times. They also made agreements with the Germans for truces and non-aggression in certain areas. Milovan Gilas, who was one of Tito's top generals, wrote a book some years ago in which he described meetings with German generals by partisan generals in which they agreed to all sorts of truce agreements with the Germans. But, history is written by the victors, and it turned out that the partisans were the victors, and this was not known until much, much later. Well, the overall strategy of Draža Mihailović was very simply to try to hold on and have as many resistance fighters as he could on his side without aggravating the Germans to cause civilian repercussions until there was an invasion by America and Britain in Yugoslavia. There was a lot of hope that that Britain and America would invade German-occupied territory through Yugoslavia, which was called the soft underbelly of Europe. And the Chetniks were holding on, ready to help the invasion when they could. But meanwhile, there developed clashes between the Chetniks and the partisans. First, they were collaborating, but then the partisans set a second main goal, rather than fight the Germans, and that was to put into effect a communist regime in Yugoslavia. Draža Mihailović wanted to reinstate the royalist regime that existed before, which was semi-democratic. Partisans were totally under the control of Tito and his men, and they wanted to put in a communist regime based on the Soviet model. Yeah, well, some of the partisan strategy was actually to provoke German retaliation in order to have the Germans antagonize the local population so they would join the partisans and become vehement fighters against Germany. So the partisans were not looking to avoid civilian casualties in that regard, while the Chetniks were looking to avoid civilian casualties. Well, the main purpose of Draža Mihailović, and there were other leaders of the Chetniks as well, but he's the main one, was essentially to reinstate the Yugoslavia the way it was before, the society under the rule of the king, the monarchy, with some parliamentary aspects to it, and a capitalist system, while the partisans' leadership, well, not necessarily all the partisans, because many joined the partisans just to fight the Germans. The partisan leadership was communist, clearly members of the Communist Party, and their goal was to institute a communist system in Yugoslavia based on the Soviet model. And this was a total change in Yugoslavian society as it existed previously. During World War II, the Germans occupied Romania, and Romania in the Ploiesti area and thereabouts has huge oil resources, the biggest oil resources in Europe. In fact, nothing in Europe comes even close in having as much oil, petroleum available. So the Germans occupied it and used that oil to fuel the German war machine. Then the Allies started a major campaign of bombing the Romanian oil fields. And over thousands of U.S. and British planes bombed it repeatedly. The Germans put up a huge defense, including a defense from the ground, the anti-aircraft fire, German fighter jets and so on, and hundreds of British and mostly American airplanes were shot down, and many hundreds of airmen from Britain and the United States, again mostly from Britain, found themselves in German-occupied territory in Yugoslavia. The airplanes were shot down. They couldn't go on anymore. They parachuted or landed in Yugoslavia. And there they were, for the most part, found by the Chetniks. And the Chetniks guarded and protected and fed these airmen for quite a few months and took care of them, partly because they were allies and partly because of the fact that there's a tradition, Serbian tradition, of hospitality. And also in much of the rest of Yugoslavia, there's a Serbian saying, can I say in Serbian? Dobro došli naši gosti, vama meso nama kosti, which means, welcome our guests, you can eat the meat, we'll eat the bones.
As a member of the CIA, or OSS really at the time, I volunteered to go into Yugoslavia on a mission that was called a Halyard mission. This was to evacuate 50 airmen, American airmen, who had been shot down and were now being harbored in an area called Pranjani. We finally made it into Pranjani on August the 2nd, 1944. And we found not 50 American airmen, but 250 American airmen. They had been sheltered there and protected by General Mihailovic. The Serbian people, and I cannot say enough about them now, had also sheltered them and protected them against the Germans, and they fed them out of their own rations that they really couldn't afford to do. Because you must remember that the Serbs had been raped by the Germans, ravaged by a civil war, and they didn't have two nickels to rub together. But as poor as they were, and as much as they lacked for their own personal well-being, they still shared with our Americans. And if they were wounded, they gave their bed up to the Americans. And I get a little emotional sometimes when I talk about them. But they slept on the floor while our American boys slept in their beds. They fed them food that they needed for their own family so that our boys would be fed. I want to emphasize that we as a nation owe the Serbian people, and we cannot say that about very many nations. Most of the nations in this world owe us, but we owe the Serbs because they took care of our boys in a manner that no one else could have done.
Well, airmen were crashing all over Central and Eastern Yugoslavia, but mostly in Serbia and Bosnia. And there was an attempt, the Germans were anxious to capture them for all sorts of reasons, obviously because they are enemies, and also to get intelligence from them about plans, U.S. and British plans against the German occupiers of Eastern Europe. So there was a race between the Germans, who were trying to capture the airmen, the Chetniks, who were trying to rescue and take care of them, and the partisans, we have to say, partisans were also trying to rescue the airmen as well and to get on their good side, because they were hoping that the British and the Americans would start favoring the partisans more. At the beginning of the war in Yugoslavia, Britain and France officially accepted the Chetniks as the main resistance force and gave them quite a bit of assistance. And Draža Mihailović was hailed as a hero. In fact, at one point he was on the cover of Time magazine and he was Man of the Year. But the partisans were using propaganda and trying to curry favor, but also getting the airmen. Most of the airmen were actually taken in by the Chetniks. The vast majority, a very small number, were either captured or taken in by the partisans. And there were other groups which were also trying to get to them, including in some areas
in Albania and Kosovo. There was an Albanian SS unit that was very active as well. The Mikhailovic Chetniks gathered together several hundred of the airmen who were forced to parachute into Bosnia and Serbia or land there because their planes crashed. The Mikhailovic for quite a while was trying to get the U.S. and Britain to come and rescue these airmen and bring them back to safety into, by that time, occupied Italy or other places. And he actually has sent repeated wireless messages about it to Yugoslavian government in exile. There was King Peter of Yugoslavia had gone into exile, a number of the other previous leaders who had gone into exile. And Mikhailovic sent the wireless information to Fotic, the Yugoslavian in exile ambassador to Washington, to tell the U.S. and Britain that these people were there in their hands, they were taking care of them, and that they should try to rescue them. For some reason that seems to be more political than anything else, these messages were ignored for several months. By late 1943, early 1944, the U.S. and Great Britain had turned against the Chetniks and charging them with collaboration. This is partly because of the fact that there were several pro-Russian communist agents in British intelligence who were giving the British government information saying that the Chetniks were all collaborators. Draža Mihailović, the main leader of Chetnik, was by that time general and made the war minister, was a collaborator. Yes, one of the leading ones was a man called James Klugman, who constantly gave information which was anti-Chetnik and praising the partisans as being the real fighters, while the Chetniks were all on the side of the Germans. And he was giving information that the Chetniks were actually capturing airmen and cutting off their ears and turning them over to the Germans, which wasn't true at all, which is a total lie. It wasn't widely known that Klugman and a number of his associates were really secret agents for Joseph Stalin and communism until in 1980s. Then they started discovering more information about it, and they found out there was a whole network of Soviet spies in the British intelligence apparatus who were deceiving the British government on the behalf of the Soviet government of Russia. And one of the ways that this was known was after the fall of the Soviet Union, a lot of the Soviet archives were opened, and the former KGB information, a number of the former KGB people started telling everybody of what was going on. Documentation was made available. This was a really very major spy ring, a misinformation ring, doing whatever they can to help the Soviet Union, because the Soviet Union was considered by the communists around the world as the highest development of society in human history.
Unfortunately, Klugman happened to be a mole, a communist mole, that interviewed Tito. Tito wined and dined him. Klugman was also an alcoholic. And Tito sold him a bill of goods. Klugman never bothered to go to see Tito or Mihailovic. He just stayed with Tito. He didn't get Mihailovic's side of the story. He went back to Churchill, and there's another fellow by the name of Deacon, who was also a mole for the Russians. He was in the British Secret Service, and he reported to Deacon also. And Deacon and Klugman went to Churchill, and they said, oh, Tito's doing a wonderful job. He's fighting the Germans. Mihailović isn't doing anything. He's collaborating with them. And they sold Churchill a bill of goods. And Churchill decided, okay, since that was the story, he would back Tito. And he had to get, Stalin, of course, was thrilled. Roosevelt was a sick man, and he went along. They had put enough pressure on him. He went along with it. So the decision was made to back Tito and not Mihailović. And that is why the British did not want Mihailović to get credit for rescuing the airmen. Because if he rescued airmen, how could he be a collaborator? It didn't make sense, you know? Hell, if he were a traitor, he had three OSS personnel, Jabilian, Muslin, and Ryasic. He could turn them over to the Germans, who would have been tickled pink to have us.
And because of Klugman and also other sources of information, they had decided that Tito should be backed as the main guerrilla leader in Yugoslavia rather than Draža Mihailović. So they were dragging their feet on rescuing hundreds of Allied downed flyers who were in Bosnia and Serbia. Well over 500 eventually. Well over 500. And it seems to be that it was certain American intelligence officers of the OSS, especially Voinovich. George Voinovich apparently was told by his wife, as a result of information received from the American Serbian community, that there were hundreds of downs of pilots and airmen in Chetnik hands, and that nothing was being done for them. So he started organizing and pushing for a rescue attempt. And after a while, he managed to actually get the approval of the White House for a rescue attempt. Yes, Voinovich was born in America of Serbian parents, and his wife was actually born in Serbia, Serbian woman who had been taken by Voinovich to America as well. They married, and she was working in Washington, D.C., actually, and she was in contact with parts of the Yugoslavian diplomatic staff and government in exile people who happened to be in Washington, D.C., and they actually told her that Draža Mihailović is asking for an Allied rescue of these flyers, repeatedly asking. Mihailović was sending messages to the Serbian government in exile, especially the U.S. Ambassador Fortich in Washington, D.C., that there should be some kind of rescue, and nothing was happening. So she told her husband, and her husband actually who was able to confirm what his wife told him, because he was in southern Italy, and he was an OSS officer in the military, and he managed to use his connections and influence to get approval on the highest level for a rescue attempt, including approval from President Roosevelt himself, and also approval from one of the leading Air Force generals, General Nathan Twining, that there should be a rescue attempt of these hundreds of airmen who were increasing in number constantly. There were more being shot down all the time because of the German defense of the Romanian oil fields and the Allied constant attempt to bomb them so that Germany would be deprived of the only major European source of petroleum. There were hundreds of additional ones coming every month, and this was increasing constantly. Nothing was being done for them. So George Voinovich managed to get on the very highest level of approval to start an operation to rescue them, and that was called Operation Halyard. Well, Operation Halyard was planned as a major rescue attempt to go right into Ravna Gora area, which is in Serbia, which was the main center of, or near the main center of Draža Mihailović's territory, and fly in there and pick up these airmen and fly them right out. Voinovich's plan for the rescue of the airmen was met with initial skepticism by the high command, political and military high command of on the western side. The skepticism was there because of the fact that this was occupied territory. Yugoslavia had, at that particular time, there was at least six major German divisions occupying Yugoslavia. This was also an area which had no airfields or anything like that, where these airplanes, which were C-47s, which were huge transport planes, slow-moving transport planes, could go and land. There was no airfield there at all. But Voinovich did get approval, and he was able to communicate. They parachuted, sent in agents who went to the Chetniks, and they actually organized the Chetniks in that area and the local population and the airmen together to build an airfield in the middle of nowhere. It's huge airfield. They evened out the ground, they took the trees, the bushes out, they marked it with flame pots all around, and prepared the airfield for the landing of the C-47 to pick up the surviving airmen. The first flight was on August 9th, 1944. And they had a number of difficulties, but they managed to get only a few out. Next flight was much bigger. And this flight took many more out. And this flight was accompanied by about 30 fighter planes, which were basically planes of the Tuskegee Airmen. What they did was they were fighting cover for the C-47. They were protecting them in the air. And also, while the C-47 planes were picking up the surviving airmen, the Tuskegee Airmen were attacking German troops in the vicinity, so they would be occupied, so they wouldn't go and react to what was happening in Ravna Gora, where these rescue attempts were going on at that particular time.
We started out on August the 9th, actually, and brought four planes in, but it was a nighttime evacuation, and it was very, very dangerous. And we almost lost a plane, so we decided we weren't going to complete it that night, and we do a daylight evacuation the next day. In the meantime, we decided there's a German garrison at Chachak, which is about 20 miles away, and we decided we better have some fighter planes and dive bomb and strafe them so they couldn't send a garrison or a contingent out to intercept the planes and make us lose some of our pilots and downed airmen. So this is what happened. The C-47s came in, 14 of them, the next day, with a squadron of P-38s and P-51s. The fighter pilots dive-bombed and strafed Chacha. The C-47s came in and landed. We loaded them up, and they took off. The fighter planes came back and sort of gave us an aerial show to let us know they were on their way back to escort the C-47s back to Italy. And we were very happy to have a safe evacuation without losing a man or a plane.
The Tuskegee Airmen were very important in having the rescue be successful because they kept these German units, and there were thousands of Germans within not too many miles around, highly trained, very well armed, very disciplined, very motivated, Germans, who couldn't do anything. They undoubtedly they saw C-47s coming in, whole flights of them, but they couldn't do anything about what the C-47s were doing because the Tuskegee Airmen were keeping them busy in defending their own lives at the same time. So these flights went on for actually about 6 months, because there was a small capacity in the C-47. Apparently, they couldn't take much more than between 10 and 20 on each airplane, and then they had to take into account the conditions of the climate. They had to take into account the military situation on the ground, the availability of airplanes to pick them up, and also there was a constant influx of new airmen who were brought to that area and picked up by the C-47s and taken to safety because the bombardment of Romania continued. The Germans never got to the airport. The new airport that was built there, until everybody was gone. So the whole operation was extremely successful. Not one man was lost, either in the rescue crews, the airmen, or anybody else. However, there were many Chetniks and Serbians who were killed as a result of that, because in one particular incident, the Germans were so anxious to get the airmen, and they had information that the airmen were taken care of by the Chetniks. They sent messages to Chetnik leadership that if they didn't surrender the airmen, they would destroy a village. And the Chetniks refused to surrender the airmen, and the Germans went into a Serbian village of hundreds of people, and according to the witnesses and the evidence, they killed every man, woman, and child in that village in retaliation for the Chetnik support and protection of the airmen. Yes, the Chetniks informed the Americans that the Germans were threatening to destroy villages and kill civilians unless they turned over the Americans and the British and other allies as well, because there was some French airmen there. There was some other nationalities involved as well. The Americans offered to turn themselves in. They were ready to surrender to Germans in order to save the local population from retaliation by the Germans, but the Chetniks refused. They said that their first priority was to safeguard the Allies. Now, this was done for a number of reasons. They were willing to sacrifice their own people, their own women and children, and many were killed, women and children, including civilians and men. This was partly because they were Allies. This was mostly the Serbian population. The Serbian population had a very long-lasting good feeling towards America, going back to before World War I, especially World War I, when Woodrow Wilson was a huge proponent of Serbia and favored the Serbians quite a bit, and he actually was largely instrumental in establishing Yugoslavia with Serbian leadership, and also because of the whole tradition of hospitality and religious feelings also, and under the Orthodox religion that you have to do whatever you can, sacrifice yourself for your brother if necessary. The interesting thing is that even though well over 500 airmen were saved, about almost 90% of them were Americans, who might have been dead if it wasn't for the Chetnik protection. The United States and Britain had absolutely no gratitude for quite a while towards what the Chetniks did. Draža Mihailović was, after the war, on the run for about a year and a half while the Tito's troops tried to find him. They eventually arrested him, and he was in June 10th, 1946, he was placed on trial. The survivors, we have to say, the survivors of the rescue attempt, the Americans mostly, organized to help him and did whatever they could all over the country. And they actually got the United States government to request a fair trial for Draža Mihailović. They wanted to go to his trial and give evidence that he was not a collaborator, that he actually was on the Allies' side and helped the Allies. The government of Yugoslavia at that time refused to take any of their evidence.
And one morning I picked up the Washington Post, and on the front page was a little article about yay big that said the forces of Marshal Tito have captured General Draža Mihailović. Well, I had been told that I wasn't to discuss this Halyard mission with anyone, but I knew what was in store for Mihailović. So against orders, I went down to the Washington Post. I asked to see the editor, and I said, "Sir, this is my story," and I told him about the Halyard mission. And I concluded my remarks by saying, "If he's a traitor and a collaborator, I'm a traitor and a collaborator too. Put me on trial with him." I'm one little guy, I had no political clout, I'm all by myself, and it didn't catch up. But fortunately, the local newspaper in Toledo, Ohio, where I was raised, picked up the story and did publish it in the Toledo Blade. So there was an article about it in the Toledo Blade. But fortunately for me, these 500 airmen that we had rescued, they kept in touch with one another. And they formed a committee, and they met in Fort Stevenson in Chicago, and they sent a delegation, there were 20, I think it was 20 or 21 guys, into Washington, and they contacted me also, and we decided we were going to see our congressmen, our representatives, and the State Department, and we were going to do all we could to get ourselves to testify at Mihailović's trial. Well, we tried. We contacted our senators and our representatives, and they tried. The State Department sent several letters to Tito, his government, so they rejected us. Because the ulterior motive we had, if we could just let Mihailović know that we had not forgotten him, that we still appreciated him, at least he would have that knowledge. He would know that. And we know he was cooped up. We know he was incommunicado. But if he could just learn that we were fighting for him, that we had not forgotten him, this would go so much towards easing his last few moments of his life, because we knew it was just a question of time when he would be executed. Perhaps murdered would be a better word rather than executed, because that's what he was.
So he was found guilty. Draža Mihailović was executed within a few days of his trial, and he was buried in an unmarked grave. And to this day, it's not known for certain where he's buried. Some years later, Truman was persuaded by the survivors who organized into an organization trying to publicize what happened, express their gratitude. President Truman was persuaded to give the Legion of Merit posthumously to Draža Mihailović, but in a strange twist of politics, this was kept secret for many years. They would not publicize that. The United States did this secretly, and nobody knew about it. Because again, at that particular time, there was the belief that you have to have a good relationship with the Soviets, but even then, Yugoslavia, Tito, had become very important to the United States, because Tito was the first communist ruler who actually turned against the Soviet Union. So the United States didn't want to do anything that would embarrass Tito. So that was kept secret until many, many years later. After the fall of Yugoslavia, that was publicized after the fall of Yugoslavia in the 1990s, and Mihailović's daughter was given his medal, the medal of his father, Draža Mihailović.
57 years later, in 2005, we, again, a contingent of four or five of us, of the airmen who had been shot down, and myself and George Voinovich, went to Yugoslavia, to Belgrade, and presented the medal to Dr. Gordana Mihailović in honor of her dad. And this was a very, very emotional one because I had prepared an album of some of the pictures that Alan, a photographer, had given us back in 1945. And I presented it to her. I thought she might appreciate it, and she very much did. One of the highlight moments of my life, Claire Musgrove's grandson was looking at the pictures, and he turned to me and he said, "You know, if it weren't for Mihailović and for you, the OSS and you, I wouldn't be here." Well, I tell you what, I mean, to have a person tell you that, it's very, very touching, to say the least. And I guess I'm kind of an emotional guy. I don't mean to be, but I can't help it. I can stand a lot of hardship, but I can't stand much kindness, unfortunately. Again, we presented this medal to Dr. Mihailović, but there was no publicity for it. It was all almost like a secret mission of ours, you know, and I couldn't understand it. I was told by the ambassador, we had dinner with him the night before, and he said, "Well, we're in delicate negotiations with Bosnia-Herzegovina, and Kosovo was entering into the picture, the Macedonians, and I don't know what all." And I said, "Well, that's beside the point. That has nothing to do with Mihailović and the rescue mission. The truth is the truth is the truth. This happened. Let the chips fall where they may. This is what, if they have proof that he was a collaborator, I welcome it. Let's bring it out in the open instead of putting a lid on everything and not letting everyone be heard." I am biased. I admit this fully. I'm a Mihailović man. I'm a Mihailović believer. But if they can prove to me that he was a collaborator, I will try and keep an open mind. I will try and keep an open mind. But God bless it, let's get it out. Why cover it up? What's the big secret? I'm sorry, I don't mean to get on it.
When Draža Mihailović in 1944, to early 1945, was risking his life, the lives of his men, women, and children, to protect the American and other Allied flyers, he knew already that the Allies, especially United States and Britain, had turned against him, that they have declared they will not support him anymore, they will not give him any more help, and they already recognized Tito, his main opponent, as the leader of Yugoslavian resistance. Even though he knew that they were against him, he risked the lives of people to safeguard the Allied flyers, and that is something which is very a unique Christian thing to do. They turned against him, and he turned the other cheek and did whatever he could to save them anyhow. And the gratitude for that was only expressed by the survivors, but not by the governments involved.
Well, on December 27th, we finally were ordered to come out. Before we went out, let me backtrack. We asked General Mihailović, we said, "You know, it's a lost cause here. Why don't you come out with us and continue our fight for freedom in the free world?" And he said, "No." He said, "I'm a soldier. This is my country. This is where I will live and die. So we couldn't convince him to come out. And again, I think he got such a raw deal that my sense of justice makes me cry, actually.
In May 1995, on the 50th anniversary of VE Day, one of the 500 rescued American airmen, Major Richard L. Fellman, returned to Serbia. He stood at the field in Pranjani, where he barely escaped the clutches of the Nazis. He was met on the mountain of Ravna Gora by 50,000 Serbian people, who gave him a thunderous ovation. Many of those people were the sons and grandsons of the Chetniks who rescued him. A few months before this, the United States and NATO, including German Luftwaffe, had rained bombs on Serbia on Serbian Orthodox Christian Pascha, Easter Sunday. Major Fellman decided to write an open letter to all those American soldiers fighting the Serbs under NATO auspices.
During World War II, we were in the Army Air Corps list as missing in action, in the very same area you are now serving. If we may, we would like to relay to you a frank, soldier-to-soldier message about our personal experience while there. Something which politicians who sent you there have not told you, and something which you have not read or seen in anti-Serb media. In 1944, the members of our committee were flying bombing missions out of Italy over southern Europe. During that time, over 500 of us were shot down over enemy-occupied Yugoslavia and saved from certain death by the Serbian people. Ours was the greatest rescue of American lives from behind enemy lines in history, but has been kept under wraps all these years because of pressure from foreign sources. While we were there, those of us who were wounded were given whatever medical supplies they had, even at the deprivation of their own troops. If there was one piece of bread in the house, or one egg, it went to the American airmen, while the Serb went hungry. If there was one bed or one blanket, it went to us, while the Serb slept on the bare ground. No risk of sacrifice was too great to ensure our safety and well-being. One experience, which is forever seared in my memory, is the time a village with 200 women and children was burned to the ground by the Germans, because the Serbs would not tell them where they were hiding us. To this day, I can smell the terrible stench of their burning flesh. One does not forget such things. The most incredible part of our rescue was that before each mission, our bomber crews were briefed by the highest levels of American intelligence that if shot down over Yugoslavia, we were to stay away from the Serbian people as they were collaborating with the Germans and cutting off the ears of American airmen before turning them over. Only after we were shot down did we find out the amazing thoroughness with which the truth about the Serbs was being distorted. Further compounding this deception is the fact that while the Serbs were our allies in World War II, Croatians and Muslims, who we are favoring today, were allies of the Nazis, shooting at us and responsible for killing many of our fellow American flyers. In view of the lies we were told about the Serbs during World War II, we could not help but wonder if our foreign policy there today is the same anti-Serb bias we encountered 52 years ago. Could our career diplomats sacrifice former friends and reward former enemies in the name of political expediency? Could it be because in the world community there are over 1 billion Muslims and only 9 million Serbian Orthodox Christians with the same proportionate power in the global economy? Could it be because the Serbs have no oil wells and no unlimited oil money? Could it be because the Croatians and Muslims outspend the Serbs 50-1 on lobbyists, media firms, and campaign contributions? Could this be why atrocities are manufactured to make the Serbs look bad while gaining sympathy for their opponents? Could this be why the Serbs are branded aggressors in land they have lived on for over 600 years? Could our policy have something to do with the fact that there are 540 members of Congress, none of whom are Orthodox Christians? Could the State Department's bitter bias against General Draža Mihailović, the anti-communist guerrilla leader who saved us, be based on the fact that he was a Serb? Could these be the reasons the State Department has covered up the truth of our rescue all these years and opposed our petition to express gratitude for saving over 500 American lives? A petition which is supported by the 8 million veterans of the American Legion, the Veterans of Foreign Wars, and the Air Force Association, and which has been approved by the United States Senate. Could it be these are the reasons the chairman of the House Foreign Affairs Committee has also denied our petition? By saying to us there are ethnic groups in Yugoslavia who oppose it? Are we mad? You can bet your next month's paycheck that we're mad. We did not leave our families, risk our lives, and watch our buddies get their arms, legs, and heads blown off so that ethnic groups in Yugoslavia could tell us what we could or could not do in our own country. Now that the spring thaw has set in, temperatures and tempers will start to rise in the volatile area you now find yourselves. All we ask is that in your dealings with the local people, you be made aware of the eyewitness experience of your fellow comrades in arms. By speaking out now, we have nothing to gain except a burning moral passion to tell the truth, a sworn duty to protect our national honor, a patriotic desire to express heartfelt gratitude to those on foreign soil who saved American lives while they are fighting in defense of our glorious country. Now that you've been sent to foreign soil and been asked to risk your lives, we feel you should know the truth and not be suckered in by the rhetoric of highly paid public relations firms, foreign lobbyists, and self-serving politicians who know absolutely nothing of the region's history. We might also add that had it not been for the Serbian people, Air Force General Donald J. Smith, our chairman, and one of our rescued airmen would not have survived the war and been able to dedicate 40 years of honorable service to his country. Had it not been for the Serbian people, Technical Sergeant Curtis Bud Dials, another of our airmen, would not be alive today in Dayton, Ohio, enjoying retirement with his 4 children and 12 grandchildren. There are hundreds of us with stories just like those. Some of the greatest testimony to the many sacrifices made on our behalf are the many thousands of American children who are alive today solely because the Serbian people saved over 500 of their grandfathers during World War II. Some of them could very well be serving with you today in Bosnia. I was one of 3 rescued American airmen who returned last year to the former Yugoslavia to commemorate the 50th anniversary of victory in Europe with the people who saved us, and to visit the cow pasture that served as a landing strip from which we were rescued. The most moving experience of our sentimental trip was being cheered by over 50,000 Serbs who gathered at a mountaintop to welcome us, and who kept chanting, USA, USA. As American military men, we have a proud tradition of duty, honor, and country to uphold, and a fierce sense of loyalty to those with whom we fought side by side in combat. We never forget their kindness, nor do we return their battlefield sacrifices for us by bombing their women and children. The Serbian people helped us when we were desperate and in trouble. Now that the situation is reversed, we can do no less. Please keep these untarnished truths in mind as you now serve our country and all it stands for. And may God bless you all as we pray for your safe return.